A very good evening to you, ladies and gentlemen. It is such a pleasure that you are able to join us, and a particular pleasure to welcome our distinguished guest this evening, and that is Dr. Bernard Cadogan, who joins us from not, I think, directly Oxford itself, but somewhere not too far away from Oxford. And I shall take the liberty of taking a moment or two, if I may, to introduce him. So I shall share my screen in order to do that. So most cordial welcome to you all. An evening of words and music with Dr. Bernard Cadogan. This is the 7th out of 8 sessions, motivational sessions on repertoire and interpretation. These sessions I started, it was almost a year ago now, during the first lockdown, principally as a means of communicating with members of the Charles University Orchestra and Chorus. Given that, due to circumstances outside our control, we were no longer able to meet in person and make music together in the form of regular weekly choral and orchestral rehearsals and weekend retreats and workshops. We felt that at least we could stay in touch with each other, we could stay in touch with music, and we could stay in touch with our own musicalities. We started by discussing various pieces of music that the orchestra and the chorus happened to be working on just when we had to stop because of the pandemic. I did not record those sessions, and I regret having failed to do so. But when, in the winter semester last year, it appeared that, again, such sessions would be the only thing that it was open for us to do, I decided to be a little more courageous and to record those Zoom sessions and subsequently place them on YouTube. The feedback that I got was encouraging, and so that is what we are doing again this semester. But I decided to extend those sessions in two further ways. One was that I decided that we should embrace repertoire that was interesting and inspiring and enjoyable, even if it happened not to be within the recent or current repertoire of our orchestra and chorus, and in some instances, such as the bigger Bruckner symphonies, nor was it particularly likely to enter our repertoire in the foreseeable future. Nonetheless, it was great fun talking about those things. And indeed, during those sessions, we are able to look at what the composer was doing, what his friends and colleagues, and in some cases rivals, were doing, how these things interacted, what other movements can be discerned in music and culture at the time, what they wrote in their letters, and so on and so forth. Things for which, as you might imagine, there is no time when you have a group of eager but understandably impatient musicians, violinists with their instrument under their chins, and so on and so forth. They wish to play. They do not wish to hear a lecture. So we thought we could turn our disadvantage in that we're not able to meet and make music together, into a sort of creative advantage. And the second respect in which I chose to extend those sessions was to have some external guests who would come and greatly enrich our sessions, extend the ideas in all sorts of ways, provide welcome relief from the monotony of members of our orchestra and chorus having to put up with me, since I have the benefit of having friends and colleagues who have very, very interesting things to tell us. And to cut the long story short, it was, of course, with some trepidation that I took the liberty of asking Bernard if he would grace this series by taking part. And I'm exceedingly grateful that he has agreed to do so this evening. So a few brief words about Bernard Francis Cadogan, whom we have the pleasure of hosting. He's a poet, he's a philosopher, he's a very distinguished political advisor and speechwriter. He has served New Zealand, the New Zealand government, in various capacities, including political advisor since 1996, including the Prime Minister's foreign affairs advisor. And he has served as the New Zealand Treasury consultant since 2011. But something that I think few countries can boast about their political advisors is the fact that in Bernard we have a world authority in the philosophy of people like Paul Ricoeur, John Rawls, and Charles Taylor. And in his own thinking and research, he focuses also on post-colonial thought, the formation of empires, and the resilience, relevance, and viability of small nation states. And to cap it all, and not least, he is a poet of distinction. Allow me to say that his latest collection, about to be published, is called Crete 1941, which is something inspired by the Battle of Crete that took place in May 1941. The Nazis attacked Crete. They succeeded in capturing part of the island. The Royal Navy had a lot of difficulty in curbing the advance of the Germans, and tremendous human sacrifices had to be made. But anyway, I do not wish to anticipate what Bernard may have to tell us about this particular source of inspiration. One of the reasons why it is so splendid that he's able to join us is the fact that much of his poetry, including some of his recent sonnets, have been inspired by particular pieces of music. But before we enter music, a realm that once we enter, I think we shall remain there for a good while, I should also like to say that his poetry is informed by visual art paintings. It's informed and enriched by his knowledge of classical literature, which seems to me to be second to none, at least amongst my own friends and acquaintances, but also by such things as walks that he takes in the vicinity of his own residence, where he has access to some of the most beautiful English scenery and countryside that there is, and more generally by the world of ideas and all sorts of external and internal stimuli to which he is very much alive. If you wish to explore your poetry on your own, something that I would very much encourage you to dip into, he has a very elegant website, www.egeria, Company New Zealand, at this address. And one thing that I have to point out is that many of the poems that you can find on the website at present will not be there for much longer, because publishers are likely to ask Bernard to withdraw them from the website once these poems are published, for understandable reasons. So do not postpone exploring his poetry via the internet too long. As an example of poetry other than that inspired by music, one of the items that caught my attention is one which I believe he composed very recently. It's called Grappa at Dawn. So I wonder if I could start by welcoming Bernard most heartily and cordially to our session, and ask if he would be willing so very kindly to recite or read us Grappa at Dawn by way of an introduction.
Thank you very much. But I must first thank you and thank the Charles University of Prague for this opportunity. I acknowledge the occasion by wearing my Oxford gown, which I don't get much occasion to wear, but I wear it in all humility before such a venerable institution. I wish also to acknowledge the memory of the great Czech philosopher, Jan Potocka, whose books have taught me so much. So that is a primary connection between myself and new scholars of Prague. Now, Haig has proposed a wonderful selection of my verse that has quite humbled me. Grappa at Dawn is a very good beginning, but I would say the whole theme of our discussion tonight can be summed up in two words of Greek from the Iliad, from Iliad 23, line 244, in which Achilles says, Haidi kutamai, haidi kutamai. And basically it translates into Purcell's, when I in earth am laid. It means literally, when I am laid in Hades, when I sleep in Hades. As Heidegger translated it in working his translation from German into English, to be ensconced in Hades. So we are having a Virginian meditation tonight with all its mysteries, these solemnities of death, of our experience of death. And a Grappa at Dawn is not a bad way to start. And it is from an occasion. Very recently, I wrote it on the 17th. I went for a walk before dawn and had this strange encounter. I passed a woman just before daybreak on farmland, a red-haired in tartan dress and cardigan, who did not take any interest in me as she caressed her loneness fully clothed. Six Suffolk sheep were watching in the same fenced area while I went on in the raw morning, steep with sharp dew. Baying hounds were scarier in kennels across the valley, than owls bloodthirsty and not needing to drink as such. Her refused face was a howl to the last of night. Grappa would link Cesare Pavese, raw dawn and her, rising fog, none having an answer. Thank you.
Thank you for that. I shall again share my screen so that we can look at the text together, if I may. And you were inspired to compose this only 3 or 4 days ago. Yes. You must have been aware of the Pavese poem, of course.
Yes.
Could you tell us something about that? Because very few of us know it.
I love Pavese, and I learned Italian at the Victoria University of Wellington when I was 18. I also have a very good friend in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Trade, who was their Italian expert. It was he who introduced me to Grappa, and not my sojourns in Italy. But I already knew Pavese, and he and I had a very wonderful evening before I went to Oxford in 2002, discussing Grappa a Settembre. And it seems to sum up this morning ethos very well, and this encounter, what there was a need of between the woman and me, I suggest, for communion between her and I, was Grappa. And the air, the atmosphere, the rawness of things, the cruelty of things, the loss of everything, was all caught up by that very raw dawn, 5 a.m. before the sun had appeared. And she was not even looking in the direction of the sun. She was looking towards the west. And the sheep were looking at her.
Yes. And of course, you're talking about the English countryside serving as a sort of counterpoint for this encounter or near encounter, which must have been rather different from the milieu in which Pavese lived and worked.
He's describing a village of country folk getting up in the morning, and they're meeting each other and they're smoking and they're having some grappa with their tobacco. It's a very different environment, but I think that the encounter with this lady brings out the mystery of men and women and of the Eurydice theme, which we shall explore in the following sonnets. It's a gentle introduction to this wreath that we are assembling, that we are weaving together tonight.
Righty-ho. Let us continue then. I should now then consider myself to have permission to proceed to the musical thrust of this evening. It is quite a sizable and most impressive, not just in terms of quantity, but in terms of quality, a most sizable corpus of sonnets inspired by musical themes that you have created. Although you insist that you are musically not trained in any way, nonetheless, your passion for music does manifest itself in these sonnets in a manner that I find rather palpable. And you seem to have different ways of doing so. You sometimes go straight into the heart of the music. You capture the essence of the music in a way which one would have generally not expected words to achieve. So that is an aspect that I find very, very impressive and often rather affecting. But also, you seem to take care to find out as much as possible about the circumstances of the composer's own life and his own thinking, the general context, and also sometimes you, but not always, you allow something of the immediate reaction that the music engenders in yourself also to become embodied in those sonnets. And also, and this is one reason why sometimes a little bit of effort is required to enjoy those sonnets, there are rich literary allusions that go across the millennia, you know, ranging back all the way from our own time to the classical period. So from time to time, I myself, when I read your poetry, find that a little bit of explanation is required so that I can understand certain bits of the poem, even though I can often enjoy them without necessarily insisting that I immediately understand every bit of them. So before we turn to some particular examples, if we may, I have made a little extempore list based on my recollection of some of your poetry that I enjoyed in recent weeks, of composers who have been whose inspiration has manifested itself in your poetry. And I have listed them in no particular order, certainly not in chronological order, but the English composer Edmund Rabra seems to have become very important to you. Others are Béla Bartók, Anton Bruckner, whose symphonies I was only a few weeks ago discussing with, you know, at this very setting with members of the Charles University Orchestra and Chorus and their friends. Igor Stravinsky, on whom, in fact, we are about to have a session a week hence. Carl Nielsen, whose Hymnus Amoris we gave the Czech premiere of a year and a half ago, nearly 2 years ago now, and whose first symphony we performed, whose various other pieces we've done, and whose Sövnen, a cantata, a secular cantata, entitled Sleep, that expresses the tranquility of someone who is about to enter a state of slumber, but who is then profoundly shaken by a horrific nightmare until the nightmare recedes and tranquil sleep takes over again, something that is beautifully embodied in Nielsen's writing for large orchestra and chorus. It is what we were rehearsing on when, in fact, the pandemic necessitated our stopping. So we are full of Nielsen as well, and I think that you will find a particularly receptive ground for Nielsen and your thoughts and meditations on Nielsen. The Polish composer Szymanowski, Cesar Franck, Mahler, whom we've also discussed in some detail, Shostakovich, the eminent Czech composer Josef Suk, Franz Schmidt, a composer who is not as well known as he deserves to be, and I'm very glad that in this instance it was my own shy suggestion that resulted in your exploration of his music and particularly of his Fourth Symphony, but also other composers such as Rossini. So if I have not omitted anyone important from this list, And if you agree, we could proceed to looking at particular musical items. And I propose that we proceed by playing for a minute or two a musical excerpt, and then you might very kindly favor us with a sonnet that you have written inspired by that very piece.
Yes, I agree. What I look forward to in this exercise is the experience of how poetry goes through its own silencing before music.
Yes. Yes.
It does experience its own silencing. That's not the only alternative. It could find song. That's something else. But in this case, poetry discovers its silencing. And this is a form of concealment and disclosure that is entirely reciprocal. And this is what we shall try and enact tonight.
Let us start with Mahler's Fifth Symphony. I had initially chosen to play the opening bars of the Scherzo, but then I reread your poem and I thought, no, it has to be the first movement because the funeral march is explicitly mentioned in the poem. So let us hear a little bit of the Karajan Berlin recording of Mahler's Fifth Symphony, if we may. It is always difficult to stop the music, but we have reminded ourselves of this magnificent symphony. And if you could possibly now read us your sonnet on this piece, Bernard.
Thank you. Mahler begins with a funeral march. The hearse and band abandon Acheron as music expedites its own demarche, fast and virulent beneath the baton. A torrent's ruin and detonation to survey lives and all their timings denies bounds to this new creation, fungible to the counterpoint's priming. Love is here, that was a fountain sealed yet burst open, with her proper tempo and his life restored. Bodies the more real for death's being, and Mahler's memento. The lovers have recapitulated. A fifth symphony has to bury fate.
I find that very moving. Let us now move to the next slide so that we can see it in front of us. My first question would be, could you explain to us the reference to Acheron?
I have my exploration of music, as you will recall, began at New Year when I discovered Bruckner. And I was like a child in a toy shop. And so I had a Bruckner binge, and you were my director in these
investigations. In a very small way.
And what I said to you about Bruckner is that I found all the prophetic spirit and the sort of the time mysticism of Virgil were present there. But in Mahler, I find the profound compassion and catabasis of Virgil. And there's that wonderful line that Virgil has, felix qui poterit, felix qui poterit, rerum cognoscere causas, happy is he who knows the causes of things. And what he's able to do, what such a person is able to do, what he or she is able to do, is spurn and place beneath the heel the roaring of hungry Acheron, strepitumque Acherontis arari. And I find that very much something that happens here. The symphony abandons it. The funeral procession abandons its own dola, its own pomp funèbre. I was also inspired by Bruckner's Sixth, where I discern Neapolitan traces, and again a funeral march. And it was only after listening to Bruckner that I listened to Mahler, and there it was a very explicit funeral march, one that turns into something else. But that's the reference for Acheron. There are four rivers of the underworld, classically speaking, Styx, by which the gods promise, Acheron, fiery phlegethon, this is the Feuerbach, they all have their own perils, but Acheron is the river of absolute destruction, and of course Lethe, the river of forgetfulness, but Acheron is the black hole of the piece.
Thank you. And the other thing that immediately struck me when I read this sonnet is that you are very much aware of the fact that love is here. Love permeates the symphony, not just the adagietto, but the other movements as well. Even the funeral march, there are moments of consolation and the occasional feeling one gets of a smile behind the tears. But why was the love as a fountain that had been sealed and then burst open? Or how did the music evoke that idea?
The music progresses in this very sophisticated piece in such a way that I just felt that well forth and explode like a river does coming from a hill's pressure. And I found it, you can talk about inexorable fate as Virgil does, and that's something sad, that's something of tremendous grief, but you can also talk about inexorable love, the inexorable pressure of love, and I felt that this symphony yielded that.
And once we are on the subject of love, you mentioned the lovers have recapitulated. Do explain what you mean by that intriguing thought.
Well, they have not capitulated. So there's a lot of controversy about Martin Heidegger's thought and his definition of Dasein as being towards death. I think what is explicit in Virgil and why he makes a very good psychopomp for Dante is that the persona of Virgil and his own verse make it very clear that death is not our entelechy, that it's not our teleology. It would be crude to say that Heidegger said that, implied that, but Virgil is very expressly stating the contrary. And what we find here is a love that mattered all the more. And its fate, was its destiny was not death. We have a life away from death, even though that is the end. And it was, I'm not using any resurrection or anything like that. I don't think that Marla gives warrant for that. I don't want you to have the music or the poem do any mythical tricks or pull rabbits out of hats, but there's a sense of having remembered each other and the memory being mutual across time. Lovers remember each other across time. Even though they may be sundered by death, there is her memory of him before she died and his remembering of that. There are ways in which people can be in contact without invoking a seance or anything like that. There are ways in which in normal existence, we can recapitulate the other. We can recapitulate the other and remember another's recapitulation of us in response to us. And I find the pathos of Virgil consists in these dissonances of time, in people's encounters with one another across dissonances of time. That's the underworld experience, it's the Hades experience. Again, Haidi Kutamai, which is the theme for tonight.
And of course, this symphony did evoke those thoughts which you have embodied in this sonnet, although you have done so very lightly, of course.
Yes, the sonnet is a form that, of course, is very roomy because it is so small. The aim is to not make it tight. My sonnet is inspired by French masters. And the French are able to discover infinite room in a very small space. The trouble with the English sonnet, take Shakespeare's for example, is that they are incredibly tight. And there is a density to them, and it's almost suffocating. Whereas the French masters like Jean Cassou, taught me how to create this room.
Thank you.
So there was a structure to them that can be like a cantilever bridge or a suspension bridge, and it can bear appalling weights, great dolor, great sorrow, tremendous joy. All sorts of emotions can be borne on a very light frame with a good sonnet.
Let us turn to the next musical piece that inspired you, if we may. Remaining with Mahler for the time being, Mahler's Ninth Symphony. I shall play a little of the last movement, if I may. Again, to prepare the ground for the sonnet inspired by this symphony.
Thank you.
Again, with the greatest reluctance, it pays me every time I have to do this, but I have to stop the music. I also feel rather guilty about starting to play the last movement, because it is in a sense a shame to do so without our having been through the experience of the previous movements. Nonetheless, we have had a flavor of this highly evocative masterpiece. And may I invite you, Bernard, now to read to us your sonnet inspired by this symphony.
No more Faust. When does a life have enough? When it has enough of loss. For heaven is how birds migrate through the sky's rough confluences, and death works its leaven into the traveller they left behind. The pace is as solemn as the pact agreed on, but less steady, unwinding the pulse, before scribbled score cataracts into a gulf, and spring turns ironic in its thaw. The idea was to let art have renewed youth and live diachronic across lives of false ends and many starts. The coda is coma, the deal is done. Silence utters death. Faust and we are one.
So let us give our viewers a chance to revisit the text, this time on the printed page. The first thing that comes to mind is, what was it about this symphony that evoked Faust in your mind?
Well, there are some composers for whom Faust is an important persona. Mahler is one of them. Havergal Brian, the English composer, is another composer who identified with Faust. We don't need Thomas Mann's Adrian Levikun to explore this theme. We have plenty of excellent music inspired by the Faust theme. When you played the music just now, it utterly arrested me. It caught me, but nothing, I think, captures the conclusion of Faust. This is before the Rococo putti appear and all of that. This is Faust completely yielding of himself. And it's when the sense of all lives, all falsehoods, all possibilities are utterly exhausted, and he is lost enough.
Yes, I begin to see now, because the symphony, you could say that about the symphony, yes, very much so. But initially it was very strange, you see, because when you mention Faust and music together, I think of an opera that I worked on some years ago, namely Gounod's Faust.
Yes.
But this is a very different world.
I was resisting my own profession in politics, and I was resisting my response to Schumann, to Schumann's Faust. I was resisting that. And so I did not want to consider the end of Faust's life as a party political broadcast. I was thinking more of Marlowe's Faust.
Ah.
The absolute loss and devastation and exhaustion of Marlowe's Faust with something of the losses in life of Goethe's Faust. And I consider Mahler's Faust to be a fusion of Mahler's and Goethe's.
I see.
I won't invoke Thomas Mann, because that is subsequent, that's a sequel to all of this. So I see that the tradition of the German lands about Faust are combined in this magnificent piece of music. There is both devastation of life, there is a moment of absolute loss, but there's also the recapitulation of profound loss, as in Goethe's Faust, And there's also on my part a resistance to Schumann and to my own profession. Now, the reference there to the scribbled score cataracts into a gulf.
Yes.
The score does definitely do that. The music does sound like a scribble in certain parts. But again, this is Acheron. This again is the Virgilian theme. And I think that Mahler has fully expressed katabasis here. Aedi kutumai again. And we are at one. When that silence comes at the end, which I compare to a coma, we are Faust. He is us. An unusual communion is achieved between Faust and us. Faust is no longer this strange genius who has made a pact and done unusual things with Mephistopheles. We are him, and he is us. And I think this is a very... Mahler is able to evoke the communion that is love between lovers, but also another kind of communion. And here we have this encounter that is beyond a mere meeting, but is a communion. And it's extremely solemn.
I wonder whether this idea could actually be taken further in connection with Mahler's 10th symphony. Have you had the opportunity of listening to Derek Cook's completion of Mahler's 10th?
No, I shall write that down. I shall write that down. Here we
are. Because it occurs to me that if anything, some of the things that you have mentioned may apply even more so to Mahler's 10th.
Yes.
I'm just thinking aloud. You may, in fact, upon hearing the symphony, take a different view on the matter.
This was a costly sonnet to write. The music was costly to me. It really evoked things in myself, and you might say that the sonnet was written with blood inflicted from this music. The music was such a surprise. And I saw all Faust's converging.
I see.
In an extraordinary communion in which we are implicated in him. It's literally a sacrifice of Faust, and we are communing.
Let us proceed to the next piece, then, if we may. And that's a very different world. One where perhaps Faust will not be seen to be so prominent, namely that of the Scandinavian landscape one associates with, Sibelius is a different landscape, but Nielsen also, if one thinks of the Danish countryside, has a certain connection to the land where the music, from which the music drew its inspiration. This is a little bit of the Nielsen flute concerto that I should like to play now, if I may. Okay, again, it is arranged to stop it there. But would you share with us the sonnet that you wrote upon hearing this work for the first time, please?
Though keen about modern times, the flute saunters round. The piper makes a window on the pastoral, but angina shoots its panes. The country is overshadowed, and raw nature drops to a threnody Friedrich II could have learned to play at Sans Souci. There is no remedy save soliloquy, which words do not say. The pipe flaps and flounders like a bird, tries to pick itself up and resume, but splutters out. A trombone is heard in derision after the flute exhumes itself from silence. Despite such scoffing, the dying piper is not put off.
Thank you. Let us now look at the text again. You mention angina's pains. Are you thinking of the composer? Are you thinking of the biographical circumstances, the fact that Nielsen was in poor health at this point?
Yes, this is a man writing about his own dying. I put him in his own. This is a more of an historicist poem because I refer to Charlie Chaplin's Modern Times. And that is contemporary with Nielsen.
So it is, yes.
Nielsen is a composer. It's you who introduced me to him, whom I regard with great affection. There is a big smile on my face inside me when I think of Nielsen. I have quite a solar feeling about Nielsen. Not least because I have now reached 60 years of age biologically.
Oh.
And I was a fetus this time in 1961, at least. And I will turn 60 later this year. And I know what he's on about. I know the experience of I'm now in the same sort of position, although I'm not ill as he is, but there are some things that become very evident at that age. Again, that's the Virgilian theme, and aeti kurtamai. What I love about Nielsen is how intelligent he is and how modernist he is in attacking the pastoral. He has an anti-pastoral, because one of the big themes about modernism and poetry and music is, well, where has the pastoral symphony gone? Where has pastoralism gone? Where has the bucolic gone? And Nielsen pulls no punches on it. Yes, he does evoke the sea, the shores, the forests, the interiors of the islands of Denmark, but it's not in any landscapist way. It's not in any romantic way. It's incredibly critical. It's harsh, but also very loving. And the other thing I like about Nielsen is how close he is to the world of Charles Dickens, of that England next the sea of the 19th century, how close he is to our Tudor past, for those of us in the British world, our Tudor past of sailing, of ships, all of Shakespeare's shores, Dickens' shores are there, but also this anti-bucolic or anti-pastoral is shown in the theme of the piper, because the very beginning of Elizabethan verse is the theme of the piper in Edmund Spenser, in Colin Clout. The piper is a very important pastoral figure in English verse, and I find this fully evoked. And of course, the soliloquy, I'm thinking, of course, of Hamlet.
Right, because I was going to ask, what do you mean? There is no remedy save soliloquy, which words do not say.
Yes. And the again, poetry experiences its silence in here. The poem is not a piece of drama like Shakespeare. It does not, it refuses to go into song. The poem is refusing to be song. Yet I refer to the Danish soliloquy, to Hamlet. And Nielsen is exposing his condition. And this is a time before bypasses, before heart transplants. The doctors would have prescribed digitalis or something like that for him. And he would literally have been dangling on a thread for about 5 years. So I have great love for him. That's one of the great benefits you have done me, is in encouraging me to explore his music. And there was just such a thorough liking in me for him.
Our chorus and orchestra also have derived great delight and satisfaction by exploring some of his works. This was the first piece of Nielsen to which I was exposed. If I may very briefly indulge in a bit of autobiography myself. As a conducting student at the Guildhall School of Music and Drama, I found myself that, rather alarmingly, one of my duties was each Monday morning to conduct from 9 until 11, no, sorry, from 9.30 until 12 with a half an hour break, the second year orchestra, which was something like a repertoire orchestra, on a different concerto with a third year soloist who had won high marks as the soloist. So there would be a different concerto to conduct every Monday, and the session would be recorded, and there would be a playthrough within that 3 hour rehearsal, morning rehearsal. And then the soloist would be given an edited version for to take away for his or her portfolio. But the reason why it was very alarming was that I would find a score in my pigeonhole on Friday afternoon for me to learn and then conduct on Monday morning to be recorded for this student to take away. So it was quite a responsibility, and it forced one to learn to work quickly somehow. And one of the first things that I received was Nielsen's flute concerto. And when I looked at it, I really didn't know what to make of it. But when we started rehearsing it, the poetry of it emerged, a certain starkness. It is stark, and even, as you say, harsh at times, but full of love at other times. And a simple melody has enormous power when it appears. And this I find in the symphonies of Nielsen also. But you mentioned anti-pastoralism. That's quite an intriguing thought, and I believe it is similar ideas that lead us to the next item that you chose, which is Bartok's Musique Nocturne. Now, in this instance, I propose that we listen to the piece, because it's not very long, or at least we listen to some of it, as we all glance and silently read your sonnet evoked by this piece, if we may. Thank you. In this instance, Bernard, I have to say that it was the other way around. You introduced me to this piece. I didn't know it at all. I read your poem. I loved the poem. I was intrigued by it. And it drove me to seek out the piece and to listen to it. You have evoked things that one visualizes upon hearing the music in a glorious way, very detailed, the asymmetrical way in which these droplet-like notes are being heard, water dripping unpunctually, as you put it, the pond quivering, the frog getting away and then re-entering the pond, the Baroque chorale developing into a burned-out castle. What a gloriously evocative phrase. And the pastoral does not herd or flock, it is solitary. The plain is prone, listening hard to distance for a pond's zone.
So what I've done,
yes.
What I've done here is I have done a chiastic contrast. What you and I have done here is create a chiastic contrast between Nielsen and his anti-pastoral and Bartok. And what Nielsen, both men open up a space where the traditional pastoral would fit. In Nielsen's case, he opens an aureole. And he's very unsentimental about it, where we expect to have something lush and a locus of menace and a countryside that is like a constable painting. We get something that is that darkens very quickly. And that's why the figure of Frederick II with his flute occurs, because he was a warlord. And then the aureole closes. Here it's different. Bartok has this vast space, as vast as the Hungarian plain, in the middle of his music. And the human world is a problem. So just as I invoked Friedrich at Sanssouci and Nielsen, here we have the Baroque. And we have a problematic human world. And yes, the pastoral does not herd or flock. It is almost an anti-human world. The human thing is to listen, but so do the animals as well. And there are no herding animals here. There's no agrarianism. There's no pastoralism. And insofar as the human world turns up, it is a burned out castle. It is a Baroque that is a prison. And just when we are anticipating some familiar music in Nielsen that is like Beethoven's Pastoral Symphony, or just like when we are anticipating something Baroque and progressive and mathematical, we find it's a prison. We find it's a jail. And now that we are in these difficult 2020s with their geopolitical pressures, we may look back on the 1920s now and look at this modernism in a new light and appreciate the intelligence of these composers writing for very dangerous and fraught times. We are back, I'm afraid to say, in the same kind of space, and we need to find this art again. This Virgilian art. I have great love and affect for Nielsen. He was not an intellectual, but he was a genius, an abundant genius. Bartok's cold cerebrality perversely appeals to me. And he's so unlike anything that I know from New Zealand. We don't have a great Hungarian plain, and we don't have ponds like that. But I like what he does to the human world. And again, I've used the historicism in contrasting ways. In Nielsen's case, it's everything from Charlie Chaplin to Friedrich II. Here I bring in the Baroque. And the Transylvanian plain is filled with burnt out castles.
Thank you. Thank you. Let us now move to the next piece. Now, we mentioned Bruckner several times, so here he comes. And this will be, I think, the scherzo. Thank you. Again, I hate to stop it there, but I should very much now like to hear your sonnet, Bernard, which you wrote inspired upon first hearing this symphony.
Bruckner's music is stronger than the world that descends on it at daybreak to hunt. We can hear the first tits, the mist swirl. We can hear nothing, not even a grunt or bawl from the quarry. What is the chase after, unless a hunt of the music after us in turn, as it replaces the barrel organ decoy, ludic and repetitive in the clearing? We miss the answer to the woodwind's question. We fail to keep our bearings in the music. The French horns rescind their pursuit after all their pressure. We are at a loss. They have our measure.
Thank you. And here is the text. Now, could you explain the word ludic to me?
Ah, oh, well,
because I thought if there were two D's, one would think of something that is Luddite, but it wouldn't fit the context, and there is a single D.
This is homo ludens, man at play.
Ah.
The concept from Gadamer, man at play, homo ludens. So this is play. Now, Bruckner had a big public relations problem after the failure of his third symphony, which was a work of apotheosis for Wagner, but neither the orchestra nor the most of the audience appreciated it. And even the orchestra ran away before it was completed. So he wrote something like Virgil's Eclogues for his fourth. And his fourth symphony was an accessible work that lured people in. It lured Viennese society in, but the intelligence of Bruckner is not to be ever underestimated. We are dealing with a mighty architect here, and what has he lured us into? I listened to the symphony after listening to the fifth. And the fifth symphony required three listenings from me before I was able to make any sense of my own of it, but the fugue most impressed me. And I thought, after hearing the fourth, I thought, wow, why don't I have a fugue chasing a fugue? Why don't I have a hunt after us, and we're after the music, when we think we're after the music? And I think that is a conceit that would have appealed to Bruckner. And again, what's Virgilian about this? Well, there's the eclogic theme, the Georgic theme. This is Virgil of the countryside, but this is a dark countryside. It's never merely pleasant. It's never merely the locus amenus. And there is death here. There is the hunt. There is the spoil. Something is going to be ravaged and killed. So Bruckner makes no bones about this. There would have been people in the audience who would have thought this was all hearty, good fun, wholesome. Bruckner's too smart for that, and he did not personally hunt. He was not that kind of man. So the music has our measure. The quarry has our measure. We are the quarry. Music comes after us. And I was realized I'm writing this exuberant poem after listening to this exuberant music, that I had really wanted to write something like that all along. And I was just so grateful to Bruckner for that opportunity. But it was wrestling with his fifth that made the fourth possible, my sonnet on the fourth possible.
And the fourth symphony is still a gateway to Bruckner's world. It is perhaps the easiest way of gaining admission to this canon of magnificent but not particularly easy pieces.
I think it's good to enter into his prophetic vision. into his mysticism of time and chronosophy through an eclogue, just as we do with Virgil. And starting to read Virgil, one should read the second or fourth eclogues, work your way through the Georgics, and then the Aeneid comes into shape. And I think this is very much the case with Bruckner.
Thank you. Well, from Bruckner's fourth, we have moved to Shostakovich's fourth. Perhaps Shostakovich is closer to Mahler than to Bruckner, but in any event, this is the order in which I've arranged my slides. So let us start listening a little bit to the opening of the symphony, if we may, and then it would be splendid if you could share with us the sonnet that you wrote upon hearing this work. Ah, this isn't the right symphony. This is just a little prelude before the video starts. So please ignore those introductory poems. This is from the 10th symphony, but bear with me. How very irritating we are led into a broadcast of Shostakovich's fourth symphony. We have to hear a little of the 10th. Right, now we shall hear the 4th. Again, it is difficult to stop it, particularly as I know that your poem requires that we familiarize ourselves really with the whole, with the entire symphony, but we're not able to listen to it in its entirety now. Would you care to share the sonnet with us now, please, Bernard?
The orchestra builds its Magnitogorsk. It hammers and rivets its deus ex machina through Virgil's bees, the forced labor of sound, swarming from the chaos of revolution. Shostakovich mutes the police, he does in different voices, the bassoon, the oboe, and the flute, the wise trombones that made the right choices, the suppressed fanfares for the five-year plan in a muddled paranoia, stopped up by Stalin's terror. He scans his scores for suicide by agitprop. The musicians disoblige him. When does the celeste play? Prints in snow from a dove.
Thank you. Well, do tell us something about the historical context of the symphony which you have incorporated into the sonnet.
This is the time, this is the eve of the Great Terror, when Stalin was about to administer a mass purge. Shostakovich is still a young man. So let's consider, what is it like being 29 or 30 years of age, having a whole career as a composer before one, and having to stand up for what you think is right, and being threatened with correction, liquidation, all sorts of penalties that your society can throw at you. This is a parody. This is Virgil's expressly outed here through the bees. These are the bees of Georgics 4. The perfect citizens of Georgics 4. And I use them ironically here. What Shostakovich is trying to do is speak truth to power, but he does it through parody. The suppressed fanfares would have been intolerable to Stalin at the end of the symphony. It would have been sounded like pure derision to him. The meaning would have been unmistakable. The musicians refused to perform it. Then we have this miracle, the Celeste, playing in it. And I think that's like the remarkable ending of Alexander Bloch's great poem, The Twelve, when we have the mysterious figure of the Red Guards led by the Christ in the snow with the pink banner. An ending which everyone hated. Lenin, the Orthodox Church, the Catholic Church, which placed it on the index. Never was a poem more panned, but I find the same gesture here in Shostakovich's Fourth. And of course, this was only premiered much later, many years on. But it's a young man's, it's the ingenuity of a young man at parody. Frustration in the music is very evident. He's also very disappointed. The 1920s, the NEP, the new economic policy, and the first five-year plan had promised great things. It did seem to deliver them. The second five-year plan failed. Magnitogorsk was a success of the first five-year plan. The second five-year plan came undone for reasons that historians debate. Stalin blamed saboteurs and instigated the purges. Shostakovich very nearly lost his life. He nearly ended up like the poet Mandelstam. He conformed. He conformed and he made public statements of self-correction.
And the Fifth Symphony, of course, which I think he subtitled as a Soviet artist's creative response to just criticism or something of that sort, if I'm not mistaken.
I'm also responding to our times now. I was once a young man and I lived in the neoliberal era and the ideological constraints were rather loose then. But what would it be like living in a more ideological age with a state, of a Kojavian state, or a state of this nature? And it's becoming more real with techno-authoritarianism and Western capitalist versions of that, the kind of surveillance that we are under. We are closer to Shostakovich now and his problem in 1936 than we were in 1986 or 1996 or 2006. And he was a very frightened young man, but the one time wanting to shake his fist at the world and defy, in a kind of suicide by cop, and on the other hand, hauling himself back and saving himself. The reason why I use, he mutes the police in different, he does in different voices is that T.S. Eliot has that quote, was going to have as the quote for the Hollow Men, not Mr. Kurtz, he dead, from Heart of Darkness. of Joseph Conrad, he was going to use Charles Dickens' Our Mutual Friend. And there was the custom in Victorian England of reading out the newspaper at night, the court news. And someone did the police or does the police in different voices. In the case of Shostakovich, he's muting the police. He's mouthing it. He's mouthing it. We know the police are there, but he's not going, Nina, 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 no sirens, no nothing. He's mouthing, the police are here. They're in the audience. So this is a young person under extraordinary stress, to the point of suicide by his own art. So we've talked tonight about older people with angina, people who have been bereaved. Now it's time to consider youth and how youth experiences these Virgilian moments. And Shostakovich is someone who tried to say to Stalin what Virgil said to Augustus in Georgics 4, I am Orpheus, I am Orpheus. Orpheus saying to, Virgil saying to Augustus, I am Orpheus. It didn't work for Shostakovich, but he wrote this tremendous work, which young people love. And the first time I heard it, it was by a youth orchestra, a Russian youth orchestra. And it was very moving to see 17 to 19 year olds getting stuck into it.
Thank you. It happens to be my favorite symphony by Shostakovich, as it happens. But it is a very ambitious undertaking to put it on. For one thing, it needs a huge orchestra. For another, it has passages that are really rather demanding. But what a magnificent piece. Thank you. Now, we turn to another instance of a young person who in this case is bereaved, namely Josef Suk, and his magnificent symphony, the Azrael Symphony. And this recording with the Czech Philharmonic Orchestra and Václav Talich, made in 1952, to my mind, has not been surpassed. Now, tempting though it would be to listen to the entire symphony together now, it takes just slightly over an hour. So I shall try and take us to the 15th minute so that we can hear the andante to which you have referred in your sonnet. So I shall attempt to find that moment.
Thank you.
So that was the opening of the second movement, although of course all the movements are connected to each other and they follow each other seamlessly. And we heard the theme, which is a quotation from the Dvorak Requiem, as many of you will know. So Bernard, it would be a great pleasure to hear you read your sonnet inspired by Suk's Azrael symphony, please.
In this case, a young man lost his mentor and the woman of his life, daughter of the former. Like Dante's protector gone, and no paradiso to quarter the dead in. A bestiary of bassoons, cor anglais, bass clarinet harbors the deadly piccolo. Suk maroons the adagio, holds the string's ardor, but ensures the soliloquy cello responds to his wife's voice in the lead violin. Music leaves elegy's shallows and goes where Eurydice should recede, but does not do so, nor is she brought forth into deaf sibyl and guide, metamorphed.
And here is the poem.
Now, you'll notice I did a correction there in line 13. Nor is she brought forth. I've corrected it subsequently, and I just need to update the online version. So, right. What I want to say about this is back to the concept of Haiiri Kutumai. That I may lie in when I should lie in Hades. In this case, the young man does not lie in Hades. She does. He is left behind. His Dvorak has died. His daughter, who's been his wife, she has died. He is left behind. So what we have here is a fracture of male narcissism. The male narcissism of Achilles, because Achilles is the one who says the line, Haiiri Kutumai. This is fractured here. And we have the Eurydice moment in Georgics 4, when thrice the name Eurydice is called out by Orpheus in Virgil's masterpiece. And this is something Dante replicates in Purgatorio. In Purgatorio, Canto 30, lines 49 to 51, Dante realizes Virgil was no longer there, and he calls out Virgil three times. This poem was possible to me because of writing Crete 1941, because the third canto of that is an exploration of all the Virgilian themes. And I've taken it out of the shallows. I took this theme out of the shallows. And there in the case, in the depth, into the depth of the camps of extermination in World War II. In this case, it is a young man who is left behind to live. And it's not a case of haere kuta mai at all. Another has died. And this is a very, very important fracture. And he has caught it wonderfully in the music. He captures, best of anything I've heard, that voice calling out. And that loss. That what was so tangible has become intangible. And of course, the deadly piccolo. This is one of the great joys of the sonnet is that I learned from writing it according to the prescriptions of the French masters, I found that it liberated something deeply British, which is drama. One of the joys of British poetry is that it is intensely dramatic. New Zealand poetry is imagist. It is not really very dramatic at all. But what my British experience of poetry has brought out is drama, but it took the French form in its great concision and condensation to bring this out. But here we have the entire drama present. We have a deadly piccolo. We have a pushing out from the shallows into an abyssal trough of loss and grief. And he cannot say, haere kuta mai.
Thank you for this. Now, we are approaching the end of our selections. This work also has to do with loss. It has to do with a father staying behind, having lost his daughter. It's Franz Schmidt's Fourth Symphony. Let us play a little of it. Thank you. Again, it's a bit of a wrench to stop it prematurely, but I should like us to hear your sonnet very much, please, if you would.
Poets no longer try this, since words do not work. Air moves with the fabric of grief for a daughter. She is the tree that grew out of her divested leaves, not a wreath, and left a stump behind, which the trumpet or clarinet play. One blow overcomes memory, thanks to the drum's plummet and a cymbaled clash. Then the cellist numbs the bow in answer to that crooked call. Schmidt playing the role for himself he played for Mahler on the cello. Leaves stall and stop trying to reverse their cascade. The trumpet empties itself. We almost make out words, but not the ones we supposed.
Thank you. There is a reference there, isn't there, of the fact that Schmidt, who was a fine cellist, played under the baton of Gustav Mahler. But do tell us more, please.
So what has happened here is death has wrought a terrible metamorphosis. This is an anti-Ovidian poem. The girl has been transformed into a bush. This is all very charming in Ovid, but actually it's quite horrible. So I convey the obscenity of her death and the response to it through that imagery. And again, the inexpressible. The fact that Virgil has Eurydice exclaimed three times in Georgics 4 is language running out, language depleted, language forced even beyond the apophatic. And this poem is enacting this.
Even beyond the apophatic?
Yes, because the apophatic is a negative strategy, which is what I've been deploying up till now. And now we realize that our pockets are quite empty. We poor poets, but not the composer. The composer has a bit more fuel left in the tank of grief, sorry to say, but...
I would venture to argue that poets also have more fuel in the tank. It is a paradox. It is a paradox because music, we like to think, reaches parts that words cannot reach. And yet in skillful hands, one can find words that help us see and hear more in the music than without such an aid.
This is true. But what I've enjoyed about this exercise of listening to the composers and writing sonnets on them is... recovering what is a proper silence. The poem is an attempt to find a proper silence before each piece. A proper muting. A muting that is not deprivation, however. Language is trammeled by its structure of myth. I accept the teachings of Paul Ricoeur on this, that there is a nest of myth out of which language emerges into ideological forms. And I think that music may find myth, it may seek myth, it may land on Eurydice and Orpheus, it may land on any such mythos, but it's free to do so. Language must always make the effort to break out of these structures. Language is a constant, poetry is a constant exercise of breaking out of the traps that language sets us. Music has, as its primary disposition, as its starting point, a possible freedom that poetry does not have.
But music also has constraints, and music inevitably, as it flows, sets up a set of expectations.
Yes.
And good music proceeds by contradicting those expectations in a meaningful, fruitful way, creating certain tensions and then seeking to resolve those tensions in a satisfying manner. So though I'm unable to contradict what you've said, and of course I would not wish to contradict what you said, it is not entirely obvious to me that it is absolutely true, although I can see that there are elements of truth in it, but it's something that I need to think further about before I can wholeheartedly agree.
Well, I would like to bring together the one thought of Heidegger's that you and I have discussed, which is that Roussel's Marchand de Sable evoked for me the rich essence of concealedness. And that very much applies and relates to our Haydi Kudamai theme tonight. But Gadamer in Truth and Method has these lines on music. He says, and please allow me to quote, it won't take too long.
Please.
Even in listening to absolute music, we must understand it. And only when we understand it, when it is clear to us, does it exist as an artistic creation for us. Then although absolute music is a pure movement of form as such, a kind of auditory mathematics, where there is no content with an objective meaning we can discern, understanding it nevertheless involves entering into a relation into what is meaningful. It is the indefiniteness of this relation that makes such music's specific relationship to meaning. And what I like about that, and what my poems have tried to evoke in response to music, is the indefiniteness of death. You don't know where it is. You know that it is there, that it is present, but it is indefinite. Whether it's the hunt chasing after us in the Bruckner Four, or where is the loved one, or where is my own death in Shostakovich, yet it is coming. The absence of objective meaning, or of the illusion of objective meaning. And of course, movement of form. In my poor art, I've tried to attain on the micro scale, on the nano scale, a movement of form. And the irony of it is that it took a French masters like Jean Cassou and Gerard de Nerval and Baudelaire to teach me how to do English drama, British type drama, in such a concise verse form. These are the roundabout ways we Antipodeans, we Australs work. We do finally we rewire things and figure things out. So I had to do a bit of cannibalizing of engine parts to do that. So Gadamer expresses what I'm trying to do, what I think these musical pieces are doing. There is movement of form. We do not insist on a positive objective meaning. We don't insist on a unilateral meaning. It's all polysemic, but there is this scented cloud of indefiniteness, but where it is, we do not know. And it is this cloud of Dola. And it is not an illusion that it is there. This is not an illusory art. This is an art beyond illusions. And the poet fails. The poet fails in his or her catabasis. They fail. This is why it is proper that my poem is full sonnet and only take up 14 lines. They are tributes, not epitaphs. They are humble tributes. Not epitaphs on mighty works.
Let us now turn to the last composer, and it's a composer we have been in our own correspondence referring to quite a lot latterly. Am I right in feeling being proud of the fact that it is I who introduced the symphonies of Edmund Rabre to you?
I did not know of his existence, And I have been living in Britain off and on since I went to Cambridge in 1985. And of course, I knew all about Delius and Elgar, and I knew about the more modern composers, Harrison Birtwistle and others. But I had never heard of him. This was a tremendous discovery, and the fact that his early career overlaps with Nielsen and Bartok excites me. I'm susceptible to excitement, and this gives me a kick. He's very much the composer of the county I now live in. I'm 40 minutes commuting now from Oxford in a village called Woodford House, just north of Banbury in the Upper Charwell Valley. And Wibra came from Northampton, which is not far away in this county of Northamptonshire. And again, he is not a landscapist or scenic composer. He would not offer us such concessions, but I find that the texture and the depths and the light, the crepuscular light, is very much of this region. I sense the pressure of the land here that gives rise to such rivers around us here. And the other thing I would say about Rubra is there is no night. It's not like Bartok. There is no night. There's crepuscule, but not at twilight, but there is not night in Rubra. So he's on the edge. He's liminal. He's on the borders of here. He is at Cocytus. He does not actually go over, but he has another strategy altogether. And I find it quite exciting because here is someone who is English, and I find wedded in him a music of process that combines the scholastic method with the more analytical methods of modern philosophers. That's what I sense in his music. I sense music that a scholast would enjoy and a modern analytical philosopher would enjoy. And I find that characteristically English. So the logic is worked out forensically and remorselessly. And that's what makes him a little remote to some people. It's like the clouds going by in the sky. But I find him also very embodied, very tactile. And this sonnet is an attempt to explain what I find exciting about him in a way that is not merely cerebral.
May we have the pleasure of hearing you read it once aloud for our behoof?
Well, I shall try because I have not actually done it. The meter in that is all correct and everything else, but I haven't done it, so I shall give it a go. Let this be the premiere.
Thank you.
I did not expect such a scholastic working out of this country and its coombs, perfect for music as gymnastic as a centaur, horse and rider that grooms itself as all-round veterinary for the soul. The music treads the soft ridge when it does not course the academy hills or camouflage itself, a bridge between forest and stag. Rubra, yours is a theoria of wood and rude, a music that has no further course beyond its own premise. This is not mood I hear or episode, but contoured road, cleared ground and covered, sky's modes encoded.
Thank you. I should like to follow this with something that I had promised a good while ago, because you may recall that when we first started talking about Rubra, it must have been several months ago, I mentioned that my favorite symphony is the Sinfonia da Camera number 10. but for some reason you are unable to find a recording of it. Now, we don't have time to listen to it in its entirety, but would you allow me to play a little bit of it so that you might get a foretaste?
Thank you.
Of it.
Thank you. Thank you.
And this was this is recording with the Born the Sinfonietta conducted by the late Hans Hubert Schoenseler, who had much of his early career in the Antipodes, and you may know his volumes on the Dvorak symphonies and on the Bruckner symphonies. He was very much involved with Bruckner, and I see connections between Sibelius and Rubra, between Bruckner and Rubra, although he's very much an individual voice, of course. But allow me to play a little bit of the Sinfonia da Camera, Symphony No. 10 by Edmund Rabra.
Thank you.
it is so disagreeable to have to stop the music there, but I hope that you heard enough, not just Bernard, but ladies and gentlemen, to know that this is a truly remarkable piece by a truly remarkable composer, and in my opinion, a symphony that is as good as any symphony by anyone that I know. But I would love to know what your reactions are, Bernard, because this is the one symphony by Rabra that you have not yet heard before, and now you've heard, I don't know, the first 5 minutes of it.
Right. Well, it fulfills our discussion tonight of Haidi Kutumai. And we have a very English take on the Virgilian theme by a mind that is as mighty as Milton's. Someone who's attempting a grand narrative, daring to do a grand narrative of this. What I find unique about it, and why I find myself moved, is that it is neither Haidi Kutumai, when I should lie sleeping or buried. It's not the loss of Eurydice either, or of others. What he has created is a pantheon, and he's made us part of the pantheon, and it's a moment of communion with the dead, such as Mahler achieves in that ninth that we discussed, the mysterious communion between Faust of all people, that total bastard Faust, that megalomaniac Faust, yet we find ourselves in a communion with him. But here, without any such subjective considerations or personal considerations, we find this is a pantheon. This is all our grief, and this is very Virgilian. And this is what Virgil achieves in Aeneid 6. He goes from the specific case of Orpheus and Eurydice, and insisting that I am Orpheus, I have lost Eurydice, and he speaks truth to power on that basis, to the general death of all in Aeneid 6. And this is what I believe we have just heard. We've heard a fracture, again, of Haidi Kutumai, but it is on behalf of all, not because of the loss of one other. That's my feeling listening to this.
Thank you. I should like you to hear the symphony in its entirety, and I promise that by fair means or foul, I shall ensure that you gain a copy of this recording of the piece, and then I should be delighted if it should, peradventure, inspire you into writing something further.
I'm aware that this has been a very gender-focused talk tonight. It's been about one man's experience of this music, but it at least has been a three ages of man experience, of me as an older man now, of me as a parent contemplating the unthinkable with a child, but also my memories as a young man. And we have managed with these composers to capture these three ages and their response to profound loss, as well as in the context of a commonwealth of grief, this possible communion, this pantheon, which these composers from the youngest ages to full maturity were able to attain. So I must express my gratitude to you for being my psychopomp on this journey. And I think what happens is the poet fails in the catabasis, but the poem does not necessarily fail. And certainly the music did not.
I don't think any of these things or agents failed, as far as my own humble judgment is concerned. Bernard, permit me to thank you from the bottom of my heart for this splendidly enjoyable, insightful, and uniquely illuminating session, very different from all the others that we've had, and a session that has opened all sorts of doors, not only into the world of poetry and philosophy and literature, but has succeeded in shedding light on the music and helped us love the music even more and listen to it with greater insight and I do not wish to use the banal phrase with new ears, but yes, in a new way. And given that I see that we have the very great pleasure of having him amongst us, let me also salute our dear mutual friend, Professor Theo van Lint, who has joined us and to whom I owe the pleasure and privilege of your acquaintanceship. I wonder if Theo may have one or two words to add as we conclude this session.
Thank you very much, Bernard and Haig, both of you. I think I did myself an enormous favor by introducing you to one another. it has immensely enriched my life. So the gratitude is all mine. And one thing struck me tonight, and that's it's a very personal remark that one had probably more wisely kept to oneself. But listening to the for me incomprehensible daily effusion, Bernard, that you have been keeping up in the early hours, I think, the early hours of the day, not the early hours of the night, if I understand you correctly, of the discipline of daily writing, and to write on given themes. One of the things that struck me in that is the line by Seamus Heaney, "You've listened long enough, now strike your note." And so if one thing comes out of this, it's for me, as probably for others as well, it's that it makes stream in within oneself the possibilities that the culture we are inheritors of gives us. And tonight I was very, very deeply moved by having the opportunity of having two psycho pompai to make things flow within myself. And I thank you for that.
On behalf of the Charles University Chorus and Orchestra, we are both very much in your debts, because you both made this session possible. Now, what I shall do, in my habitual manner, I must at this point thank all those who will have been following the recording of this session on YouTube, and I shall end the recording and then proceed to ask all our participants if they might wish to address any questions to our distinguished guest. So for those who have the opportunity of watching this on YouTube afterwards, thank you very much indeed for watching.